My name is Nimit Kalaria. I am here to present more detail about Android internals. So today we are going to cover is about some detail about Android kernel. Then we will go to the runtime walkthrough. So that is basically boot process of the Android device. Then we will cover the binder, that is the inter-process communication mechanism in the Android. And then at last we will see layer interaction. So as we all of we know that Android relies on the Linux kernel version 2.6. So why we have chosen Android has chosen Linux kernel? So there are basic advantage of selecting Linux kernel is that we don't need to write any mechanism for the memory management, because Linux kernel provide good memory management, process management, and it has a permission based model security. It has also proven driver model. So lot of drivers are available which we can reuse in the Android. Then next one is providing is shared library support. So Android Linux is also providing sharing a library between the two processes. And the one more thing is that is it has a its own network architect layer stack. So we don't need to write a new layer stack for the Android. So apart from this, this is not enough to write a OS for the mobile device. So we have put some enhancement in the Linux kernel. So what we have, Android has added is a binder IPC driver. That is, binder is exactly the inter-process communication mechanism between the two processes. That we will see it, that what are the inter-process communication mechanism are there in the Linux and in the Android. Then next one is the SMEM, that is the Android shared memory driver. So basically this is the used to share the memory between the two different processes. Next one is the alarm driver and logger. That alarm driver is used to give a alarm to the different processes by different other event process. And next one is power management. So that is mainly used for the mobile devices, because our mobile devices have limited battery lifetime. So we need to manage the power. We try to use as much less power as possible. Next one is low memory killer. So low memory killer, basically what we do is sometime we start the many application in the our mobile device. So at one point will be reached when the your memory RAM will be full. At that time you want to start some another process. So what Android will do, it will check, okay, RAM is full, now you want to start the new process. So for the new process, Android will automatically kill some other processes which are not used by user. So that is our low memory killer. So next one is the runtime walkthrough. So the booting process of the Android is the same as the Linux. Bootloader will load the Linux kernel, and this Linux kernel will initialize the environment for executing the C code. Once this is done, Android will kernel will mount the root file system, and it will start the first user space process, which is init process. Now once init process is started, it will start the basic daemons. So few daemons are like USB daemons, that is our connected with USB port. Then ADB daemon, that is our Android debug bridge daemon. So basically this Android debug bridge daemon will allow to communicate with your computer. And debugger daemon, that is used for debugging purpose. And last one is RILD daemon, that is a radio interface layer daemon. So this radio interface layer daemon is connected with your mobile communication, like you get SMS, at that time this RILD we use. If you are calling someone, at that time this RILD daemons will be used. Now once this daemon is started, Android will start the zygote process. So this zygote, what the zygote is the main part of the Android. So what it will do, it will start the first Delvic instance of the VM. Then it will links all core library, and it will share between all the processes which is created by the zygote. and it will use copy on write mechanism. So, what is basically is thing, when you are creating starting some new application, like you pressed home button or maybe you press your contact button. So, at that time that request will be go to the zygote to open that contact. That zygote, once zygote will get the request, it will start the contact process and it will share the library between zygote and the contact process. So, that is why he used the copy on write. So, whenever contact will try to write anything which is shared between the zygote and the contact process, at that time this copy on write will be used and a separate copy will be created for that contact process. So, once this is the done, zygote is done, in it will start the runtime process of the Android. This runtime process will start the service manager. So, basically this service manager is a kind of a context manager for the binder. So, what is the use of this service manager is to use that all our application which is providing some services, which are service provider, they all will register their services to service manager. And now, whenever your application need to use some service, like you want to use a location manager, so you will contact the GPS location service provider. At that time, your application need to contact the service manager that I want to use the service of the GPS location. So, this service manager will return the binder object to the your application, and then at that time your application will be able to communicate with a GPS location manager. Next one is, once this is done, then runtime will inform the zygote that now you can start the system server. So, for that zygote will start the new Delvik VM instance and the system server code will be loaded and system server will be started. So, main purpose of the system server is to start the other Android application of the system. So, what it will do? It will first start the two native services, which one is the audio flinger and the surface flinger. That surface flinger is your screen, that is screen of your device. So, like whenever you are seeing the battery status, your tower status or maybe your something else whichever is shown in your screen, that is coming through the application which will contact the surface flinger. That surface flinger will handle your screen. Now, next one is audio flinger. That audio flinger will connected with your speaker and your headphone part. So, whenever you boot your tablet, you will listen sound, that is the because of the audio flinger. So, if you are not starting audio flinger at the boot time, you will not able to listen it. Once this is done, surface flinger and audio flinger providing this type of the services, like as I mentioned that surface flinger is providing a control of the screen and audio flinger is providing the control of the speaker. So, suppose you are writing an application for the media player. Okay, so at that time your application will use the service provided by the audio flinger. So, as we can see here that both they have to register their services to the service manager. So, whenever you will write your application you are creating some new media player or so at that time your application first will contact those service manager that I want to use the audio flinger or service provided by audio flinger, and that service manager will return the binder object, and then at that time your application can only use the services. Once this is done, starting of native services is done, it will start the other package other manager which are used in the Android, like content manager, window manager which is related with your application window, then activity manager which is used for a life cycle of the process, then telephony service, that is telephony services, as I mentioned that when you are calling someone or you are receiving call from someone, at that time this telephony service will be used. Then Bluetooth service, that is Bluetooth of your devices, package manager. So, basically package manager will know which are packages are installed for the particular application. Then connectivity service, that is related with Wi-Fi and etcetera, connectivity, power manager, that is used for managing power of your Android device, and then location manager, that is providing location of your cell phone. Once this is done, now your system is ready to run. So what will happen when you are starting the home page? So whenever you click a home button of your device, so that new application request will be go to the zygote. What zygote will do? It will create a copy its own memory layout. So basically, to make it faster, zygote will, instead of creating new memory layout for the application, zygote will copy its own memory layout, and it will see the common classes shared between the home application and the zygote itself. Those common classes are linked with the zygote, and remaining classes are loaded in a home memory area. So once this is done, home application code will be loaded in the new Delvik instance, and the new home process will be started. So once this is done, now suppose you are after opening home page, you are opening a contact. So same thing will happen, and new Delvik instance VM will be created by the zygote, and the process will be loaded. So main point is that each and every application has their own address space, their own Delvik VM. All those applications will the share library through the zygote, and those library are marked as a use copy on write. Now we will see the binder part. So what are the inter-process communication? So two processes trying to exchange the data, like suppose maybe we can write in C language that code for the two process, that both two process will use same file descriptor. They are accessing the same file at the time with same file descriptor. So they are mainly exchanging the data with each other. Why we need IPC? So as we have mentioned, both two different processes. So if both processes are on different address space, if both processes will run in same address space, at that time we do not need to do the IPC mechanism. The main reason is behind the IPC mechanism is because of its own address space. Then provide data isolation. We are keeping some data isolated from other application. We do not want to show some data. We want to only show the few data to the application. Another one is avoid direct interaction. So obviously, this is the main reason about avoiding direct interaction. Like if you are putting running two processes in same address space, then there will be no data isolation will be there, right? That second process can access any data of the process one. So let's talk about the IPC mechanism in the Linux. So first one is the signal. So that is just a signal, which is just some type of the interrupt given to the process. So in that we cannot distribute differently, which you need to create the as many signal as for each and everything, like a wake up signal, you stop signal, IO disk signal. So all those are signal we need to create it. Then pipe, that is our unidirectional mechanism, that is we can process 1 want to communicate with process 2, and process 2 want to communicate with process 1. So at that time, if they are communicating with the pipe, then we need to create two pipes. First one is to write process 1 to process 2 data, and the second one is to process 2 to process 1. Then socket, that socket is a bidirectional communication. So in that process can listen from that particular socket, and process can also write that data to that socket. Then semaphore, that is our shared variable between two different processes. And message queue, that is one process will write, two pointers are defined. First one is write pointer, and second one is read pointer. So writing process will write the data in the message queue, and it will update the write pointer. And reading process will read data from the message queue, and it will read the data from the message queue. The third one is shared memory. So, shared memory in the Linux, how two different processes are sharing the memory is the by their page table entry. So, two different process have their page table, each and every. In that page table, some physical frame are mapped on the same physical frame. Means their page table entry is pointing to the same physical frame, and that's why they are sharing the memory. Now, these are old mechanism, and Android has introduced a new mechanism, that is the binder, that is the lightweight remote procedure code. So, what was the problem with the old mechanism? Well, first one is just the processes are separate, and security hole. So, security hole in the sense, like as I mentioned, if you are sharing the memory area, so how sharing will be done? Sharing will be done at the process level, it is not done at the kernel level, because the sharing part will be done through the page table entry. So, if it is possible that third process can have same page table, will get the same page table entry, and he is able to, process can able to the access that shared physical memory area. So, those are the problem with the old IPC mechanism. Now, next one, we have provided the solution. So, what can be possible the solution is, let us move the shared IPC mechanism to the driver level. It means we will provide the driver in the kernel part for the IPC mechanism. We will use the shared memory. Here is the shared memory is different than the Linux shared memory, because the in the Linux shared memory will done at the process level, and in this thing shared memory will be done at the kernel level. So, kernel will handle this shared memory. So, we will see example for the shared memory. Then per process thread pool. So, what happened is application provider, which is the providing some services, those provider has a some pool of the thread. So, each and every thread will be handled by the particular the client. So, each and every client has a one thread. So, whenever the client request will come, client one request will come, thread one will be handled. And the client 2 request will become, thread 2 will handle it that request. So, each and every client has a particular thread. Then synchronization. So, synchronization in the sense like as I mentioned, first client will communicate, then service provider will communicate it. So, synchronization problem, it may be happen in the old mechanism, which is in a socket mechanism, because socket is the bi-directional inter-process communication. So, it may be possible that when client is writing something and server can send the data at that time also. So, that avoid that we have provide synchronization here. Next one is like let us see the binder with the service manager. So, how the binder how the client will able to access the service by provided the service provider. So, what will happen when service provider will start, it will first register its services to the service manager. For registering service to the service manager, add service function will be there in the service manager package. So, that function will be used and the service will be registered to service manager. Now, service user want to use that service. So, each and every binder has its own address and its token number. So, service user don't know that binder address and that token number. So, what it will do? It will contact the service manager. This service manager will contact, okay, that particular client want to the particular service. So, it will contact the binder driver. So, basic main work of the binder driver is to create a shared memory for the set service provider and the service user. So, binder driver will create that shared memory, and it will return the information to the service manager, and those all information like a binder address, binder token number, all those thing and shared memory area will return to the service user. And now, service user has the binder of the service provider, so he can communicate with the service provider. Next one is like as I mentioned, now by process service user has its binder address and everything. So now they will communicate through the binder. So what you, how it's working? Like process A will write something in a common shared area. So binder will notify it, and when writing is done, binder will send notification to the process B, and the process B will read it from the that shared memory area. So this is the how binder transaction will work. So let's see the limitation of the binder. So what when communication will happen between two processes, what is exactly happening? Like process 1 will send the data to the process 2, okay. So what will happen? Process 1 will send the data to the binder. Binder will do the parceling of the data. It will create the parcel of the data, and that parcel will go to the process B, process 2, and that process 2 will unparcel it and read it the data. So if your data is very large, so that time will be consumed for the creating the parcel, and then again time will be spent to unparcel that data. So main limitation of the binder is to it is not ideal for transferring the large data between the two processes. So because of that, the communication time will be increased while creating the parcel and while uncreating the parcel. Now next one is the layer interaction. So we will see that we all of you know that Android has a four different layer. Those are application layer, second one is application framework layer, then library layer, and the last one is the Linux kernel. So how those layer will interact with each and every layer, and how they will get the services from the kernel layer. So first one is your application will contact the runtime service application, and that service will directly contact to the library, and that library will contact to the Linux kernel. So another way is to do is your application will contact to the runtime service. This runtime service will contact to the native service, and that native service will contact to the library. Third one is application, which will contact with the runtime service, and it will contact with the native daemon, and then it will contact with the library. So which type of the layer interaction will happen? It is depend on the type of the application and the type of the native library. So let's see how the layer interaction will happen. So for the layer interaction we need, so what we are doing is basically we are using already written code in C or C++ in Android. So for that our application are written in the Java, which will try to communicate with the code written in the C or C++. For that we need the interface, that is our Java native interface, which will the gateway for bridge between the application layer and the library, because our libraries are written in C or C++. So your Java code will contact to a library through a JNI. So first one is the trying to contact through the runtime service. So what will happen? So first one is your application, which is running in your application layer. So it will use the binder IPC, and it will get the services provided by runtime service. So basically this runtime service is your manager started by the system server. It can be a window manager, or maybe activity manager, or package manager, anything. So that as runtime service, which is running in the application framework layer, it will use the JNI, and it will contact to a native service binding. So that is our library, and this library dynamically load the HLA library. So this HLA library is hardware abstraction layer library, which is provided specially to communicate with the Linux driver. So HLA will provide some sort of the library, like audio library, your radio interface library. So those library are presented in HLA layer, and that HLA, this library will contact to the kernel driver. So let's see an example. suppose your application want to find the location of your cell phone. So, what will happen? Your application will contact with the service manager, okay, and it will ask for the service provided by the location manager. So, here is your runtime service, which is your location manager. So, your application will get the binder from the service manager and it will use that binder to the contact to the location manager. Now, that location manager will use the GPS location provider, that is our Java written code. So, what we will do is, we will contact the already written code in the C or C++, that is our GPS location provider, that is our library through a JNI. So, it will contact to the libraries through a JNI. This library will load the GPRS library, which is provided in hardware abstraction layer. So, dynamically load it and it will contact to the kernel driver and the process response will be returned to the application. So, this way layer interaction will happen when you are getting the using the location manager. So, next one is the doing the native service. So, what will happen? It may be possible sometime you use the native services. So, like native services are those services specially made for the Android, like we see during the boot process that audio flinger and surface flinger, two are native services. So, what will happen? Application will contact to the runtime services and this runtime service will contact to the native service binding through a JNI and it will use the binder IPC. So, different between the previous layer interaction and this one is that binder will take place here instead of here, because in a previous when you are using runtime services only, at that time binder is taking interaction between application and application framework. In this case, binder will taking here between the native service binding code and the native services. This service again will load the HLA library and the HLA library will contact the kernel driver. So, let us see the example. So, here is the example of the media player. Suppose your application is somehow using a media player. So, what will happen? So, your application will contact to the media player and that media player will contact to the already built in library written in C or C++ code through a JNI. So, this media player will contact to the audio flinger, because audio flinger only will have only will able to handle the speaker part. So, that it will contact through a binder and audio flinger will dynamically load live audio hardware library and it will contact to the kernel driver. So, this way layer interaction will happen during the native services. Now, if you are using a native defaults, how layer interaction will happen? So, basically what is the difference between native service and native daemon is that native services are introduced by Android itself, and the native daemons, so those are daemons which are taken from the Linux itself. So, those daemons are taken from the Linux which are using the socket to the get any request. So, this is the main only difference, that native service will we can communicate to the native service only through a binder and we can communicate to the native daemon through a socket. So, what will happen? Your application will contact to the runtime service, that runtime service will contact to the native service binding through a JNI. This JNI will send a request to this particular socket which is related to particular daemon. That daemon will load the HLA library and that HLA library will contact to the kernel. Yeah, this is also. So, let us see the example of the native daemon. Like if your application is using a telephonic manager, like your application sending some SMS to your some other mobile. So, what can happen? Application will contact the telephonic manager. It will contact the telephonic manager library and telephonic manager library will send the request to particular socket for RILD, that is our radio interface layer daemon, and this daemon will dynamically load the lib RIL library and it will contact the kernel driver. So that's why native devots will be used, and when we are using the native devots, socket will be used instead of the binder. So let me zoom it. So this is the all over architecture. So here we can see is that first layer is your application layer. So it is containing a stock Android application, which are your application like Bluetooth, service, browser, which is coming by default in your mobile or in your Android device. And here is can be your application or market app. So those app will use the application API, they will communicate to the system server or maybe application provided at the application framework. So at that time binder will come, and that this application, this system server application framework layer will interact with the library layer. This is this one is our library layer through a JNI part. So your application framework will always contact to the library through a JNI only, and that JNI will contact to the Linux kernel. So that's it. This is our normal layer interaction between among the layer.